Good morning. Happy 2010. That was it? Wait a minute. Let's try that again. Happy 2010. Excitement, passion, enthusiasm, yes. A new year, a new beginning, a fresh start. Is any of this starting to resonate now? Yeah. 2009 is over. It's 2010. New Year's resolutions, preparations for new beginnings, new ideas, a rebound in the economy, a rebound in the world, a rebound of spiritual growth and energy. 1 year closer for the Lord to come back. Excitement, passion, come on. Here's the thing. New years are new beginnings. Amen? I have been enjoying watching people go through the end of year, brand new year cycle. For those of you who are less, are not like me, you know, because I'm a nerd, right? So I'm the internet guy. I'm the nerd in chief here at Living Hope Church. And one of the things I've enjoyed is watching all of the Facebook folks, and, you know, there's a lot of us in the room that are on Facebook, and all the people on Twitter, and all of my blogger friends, because this is what they've been doing. Oh, 2009 is ending. Let's start talking about what's going on in our lives, and what happened over the last year, and, you know, and did 2009, was it a great year? Was it a bad year? How about the decade of 1999 through 2009? Was it great? Was it not so great? How did it go? Oh, man, but I'm so excited about 2010. What is going to happen in my life? What is going to happen in my business? What is going to happen in my ministry? What's going to happen in my church? As God begins to stir us up. Because it happens no matter what. Whenever there's a milestone change, we mark time very well. Everybody's got calendars. You got calendars on your phone. You got calendars on your computer. You got calendars, people in the car telling you, today is this day. The kids in school, my daughter's like, oh, I got to be the person to say that today was January so-and-so 2009. I was so excited to just say that because we mark time. So are you excited about a new year? Are you excited for what God is going to do? Because I know that each and every one of us has at least thought about it, even if it was only for a little bit of time. I mean, I have a really good friend of mine online, and her whole thing was she went down from 1999 to 2009 and marked off every good milestone and every bad milestone for that whole 10-year period. And she came to the conclusion that that last decade really wasn't that great. Honest assessment from her. She didn't think that it was. But when we started talking about all the things that happened, really, was it so bad? I mean, you know, some things happened to her in the last year that weren't so great, but some really tremendous things happened to her at the beginning of that time. So when you even it out, is it better than not so great? I mean, when you look over the course of your life, when you look at not just 2009, but you look at when your life began to where your life is now. When you look at where I came from to where I am now, is life better? I know we tend to kind of use that rose-colored glass when we're a kid, and we think, oh, it was so great when I was a little kid, and I didn't have any responsibilities, and I just got up, and my parents took care of me, and all those different things. But let me tell you something. I remember when I was a little kid, I hated it. So for all of you, you know, the younger folks in the room, I know that I remember telling my parents, I don't like the fact that you tell me what I have to do every day. Why do I have to go to bed at 8 o'clock? Why do I have to do my homework? Why do I have to eat my vegetables? Why do I have to go to church? So now I get to make those decisions. So I'm actually more excited now about my life than I was when I was this tall. Because I get to see it in the face of my daughter when I'm telling her to eat her vegetables. I can remember what was going on in my life. So, are you excited about 2010? Are you ready for what God has in store for you? Do you believe that he's going to do amazing things in your life? Do you know it? Do you know it? Good. All right, so let me share with you a little funny story, And then I'm going to go into the message this morning. That was just me kind of getting the team fired up. Okay, so 2009, just one thing that was tremendous for me in 2009. It may not seem monumental to you, but for me, this was tremendous. 32 years I've been on this planet, I've been walking around, and there is something that I've never been able to do. I finished a chapstick in 2009. See, I'm glad I'm not alone, because I was really surprised. I was excited when I took that chapstick out of my pocket and I took the cap off and I twisted it and there was nothing left. And I was like, I didn't lose this one. It didn't go away. I actually finished it. I was excited because I completed that. And that was the first time ever in my entire life. So for me, 2009 was awesome. But maybe I'm easily pleased. But here's the thing. God is doing amazing things in your life. And this time, this New Year's Eve, New Year's 2010, as we're rolling through, as we're getting started, as things are coming up, and as we're preparing and planning, as we're going into fasting and prayer here at Living Hope Church, what are you going to do? I know Pastor Paul mentioned this morning, we got the fasting book that he, you know, has all that information in it. I remember borrowing that book. I agree with you, it is a little dry, but it does have some fantastic information about the different types of fasts that are in the Bible. Are you going to do a Daniel fast where you just decide that you're going to eat vegetables and fresh fruits and not touch anything? And hey, maybe that's not for you, but maybe that's something that you're going to do. Maybe you're going to do a full fast where you don't eat anything, and maybe some people are, you know, will do the, I'm just going to not eat from sun up to sundown. I like that one, because then when the sun goes down, then I can have a sandwich, okay? Maybe that's what you're going to do. However you're going to do it in the name of God. Do it with a heart for him. Do it with passion, because the reason you do it is not just to lose weight or to eat healthy or anything like that. You're trying to connect with God. You're trying to let God show you something. You're trying to see what it is to be totally devoted to God in a specific area of your life. I would recommend, on top of anything else you desire to fast from, that you turn off the television. I only say that because I know what that did in my life. Turning off the TV, turning off the news, to a certain extent, turning off the technology, and only focusing your mind in one specific area. Because it's hard for me, being a nerd, because I've got the phone with the Facebook updates and everything comes in, and my Twitter and all the stuff I do online, and I got to keep tabs on stuff. But when I ratchet that down and turn it down to the bare essentials and just say, okay, I'm going to focus on God and just let my time be just with him, he begins to show me how much time I really have. And you guys know I talk about this all the time, about how much time are you investing versus how much time are you just spending or throwing away. Huge, huge, huge. But I want to share with you this morning, since we're at the beginning of a new year, what God gave to me as I was talking to him about talking to Living Hope Church about the beginning of a new year. And God said, well, why not go to the beginning? So as I go through this morning, we're going to be in the book of Genesis. So if you don't have a Bible, just understand that this entire discussion we're going to have this morning is the first chapter of Genesis. Genesis chapter 1 all the way through, and then the first three verses of chapter 2. So if you don't have your Bibles with you this morning, okay, we do have some Bibles here if you want to raise your hand and ask one of the ushers to bring you a Bible. But understand that that's where we are, and that's where we're going to be for the remainder of this message today. Because it's the beginning of a new year, and God wants to share with you a little bit about the beginning. And so I want to start with, as we go into this season of fasting and prayer, this time of fasting and prayer, what God did at the beginning. So in Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And God said, 'Let there be light.' And there was light. God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day." God said, "Let there be light." So the first thing I want you to do is you're walking through this time of fasting and prayers. You're connecting with God and letting him talk to you and letting him show you some things. Is really and truly ask God, God, can you illuminate my landscape? Show me what's going on in my life. Show up like an initial just nova blast and just show everything that's going on in my life. Show me the entire landscape. Show me all the crevices. Show me all the water. Show me where devastation has taken place. Show me where restoration has taken place. And when you ask that, he does it. And when he does it, don't shy away from it. I'm talking mostly about Carlton, okay? Because I know you guys are walking a little bit better than I am. But when God comes and he shows up in my life and he tells me a bunch of stuff, I'm often kind of thrown off by it. And I'm like, oh, no, I don't want to look at that. But honestly, take a look at what God is showing you. Let him tell you, okay, this is where things are kind of off right now. Maybe you need to make a course correction, or this is where, just take a look at it. Just look at it, look at it, look at it. And then think about what you want to do about that. Because God doesn't show up with a hammer and say, you will do this. You will do that. This is where you're going to work. This is where you're going to live. This is where your house is going to be. This is how many kids you're going to have. This is where you're going to, you know, this is how much money you're going to make. And you're going to give your money to this organization and that organization and that organization. God is not like that. What God does is he gives us ideas and he says, this is my word. And he says, these are the things. This is the foundation. This is the boundaries that I've set in your life. Move within that. In my name and for my glory. So as he shows you those things, don't shy away from them. Take them in. Understand what was taking place. Understand what God was doing. And then you can move into the next part. And the next part is verses 6 through 10. And it says, God said, let there be an expanse between the waters to separate water from water. So God made the expanse and separated the water under the expanse from the water above it. And it was so. God called the expanse sky, and there was evening and there was morning the second day. And God said, let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear. And it was so. God called the dry ground land, and the gathered waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. So after God has shown you everything, and he's opened it up for you to look at all of it, now it's time to start working your way through it and saying, God, what do I do with this? What do I do with a life that looks like this? Because God, you said it was good at the very beginning. When you said, let there be light, and you saw everything, you said it was good. So God, help me to understand, what do I do with this life that you've given me? And God begins to break it down. And he says, okay, let's separate this from that. And let's separate. And so once he did that, he made a top and a bottom, the sky and the waters. And then he took the waters that were on the bottom, and he said, okay, separate that. Spread it out. Now we've got the land, and we've got the waters. And he created foundation for your life. He created areas for you to work within. We talked about it this morning. Pastor Paul mentioned it, about finding where you fit. Finding where you fit. Finding out what it is that you're doing in your life that's really not working. Or finding out what is working and put it in a place where it can work the best. You wouldn't want to try and grow an evergreen tree in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. Would you? It's probably not going to work very well. But if you find a well-watered piece of land and planted that tree, it's going to grow. Correct? So let God separate, let it be broken up into pieces so you can see what's really going on. Again, don't get into the analysis of paralysis and start looking at it and going, oh, I can't do anything with this. Just let it happen. Let God start to help you organize the things that are going on in your life, because he will show you what to do. He will help you make the right decisions. He's not going to say, again, do it this way, but he is going to say, let's start thinking about, where does this go? Where does that go? Let's talk about how you want to do this. Let's talk about, for you married folks, where do you want to, you know, how is your family going to be structured? Are you going to do this with your kids? Are you going to do that with your kids? Let's talk about the type of jobs that you're going to be looking at. Let's talk about the things that are in your life that you've gathered unto yourself. and he'll start to move things around and put them in place for you and help you move things around and put things in place. And that's when you figure out how those things, those areas of your life can be best utilized. And then God comes in and he starts to plant the seeds, help you plant the seeds. Genesis 11 through 13. Then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds. And it was so. The land produced vegetation, plants bearing seed according to their kind, and trees bearing fruit with seed in it according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good, and there was evening and there was morning the third day. As you get organized and God starts to show you the different areas where you can begin to plant the ideas, plant the things that he's showing you, plant the things that are on your own heart, you can start doing that because you've got the area clear. If you're always focused on the whirlwind, and when I talk about whirlwind, I use it a lot, that is like the, you know, the swirl of stuff that's going on in your life that you just, you can't see through it because it's, oh, well, I got to do this, and this is going to be due, and I got to get this done, and the kids need to be over here, and I got to do this with the church, and I got to do this at work, and I got to read this, and I didn't pray, and oh my God. Take a break. Let God calm you down. Let him show you how to organize things, and now you can see beyond the whirlwind. Now you can understand, well, how do I start that business this year in 2010? Well, you kind of organize some things, so look, you got a spot over here where you can start working on that. Or how do I start this ministry? How do I further increase my relationship with God? Well, look, you've got this area over here that now you can start working within, and you can sweep some things out of the way so that God can start moving. But when all you do is focus on the whirlwind, you're like that farmer, like me, okay, that plants a seed in the ground and then says, well, how's it doing? And I dig it back up and I look at it and go, well, there's nothing going on here. It's just a seed. And then I plant it back in the ground and then I walk away from it for a few minutes. Oh, I got to check it again. Does the seed ever grow if you keep digging it up? Okay, and just that's FYI for all of you folks who are like me, non-farmers, okay? My whole family, they did farming all these years, and it just didn't rub off on me. I'm just not who I am. I watch them every year go out there with the tiller and the stuff, and I'm just, I don't get it. So let's just make sure you don't put me in charge of your farming, okay? Just remember. All right, so plant the seeds. Figure out where you can be effective. Let God show you how to grow things that will reproduce themselves. And we'll get back to that reproducing later on. And so for me, as I get in that mode of digging the seed back up and I'm looking at it, looking at it, looking at it, God says, no, Carlton, you need to refocus. You need to look and kind of get your eye back on me. You need to start looking towards me. You need to look towards the heavens. Remember that initial spark of light that I dropped on you? You need to refocus on that. And that takes us into verses 14 through 19. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the sky to separate day from the night. And let them serve as signs to mark seasons and days and years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth. And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good, and there was evening and there was morning on the fourth day. So God provided that initial spark at the very beginning. He brought light into existence and said that there's light and there's darkness. And then as I've gone through in my life and I've built and built and built and I've dug the seeds back up many, many times, God says, no, you need to focus on me. So he provided, I hate to put it this way, but for me, he provided shiny things. God provided things for me to look at, to remind me of him, remind me of what he's doing, so that I could then follow behind him and not worry about the seeds that we've planted. Because when God plants the seed, he's going to take care of that work. So there's some things that you have to do. There's some cultivation that you've got to do and all of that, but don't keep digging it up. And God provides you with areas and opportunities to refocus your life. And that's what God does for me. He comes forward and he says, Carlton, here's something that's a little bit outside of your realm, but this is something that I need you to do. He says, I want you to focus on this. I want you to help this person. I want you to meet this person over here. I'm going to bring somebody into your life that's going to show up and you're going to go, well, what do I do here? And he's going to say, and then he's going to remind me, you need to follow behind, help this person out, serve, do this, do that, and help me walk and help me walk behind him. It's interesting when God does that because time begins to pass. And I start forgetting about what's going on over here. And so as I work with people, and we went through the time of building here at the church, and I did a lot of things that really are not my forte. I helped people, you know, hang drywall, not exactly my thing. I tried to move a big pane of glass, definitely wasn't my thing. I tried to help out in areas where I don't normally find myself. But in time, God showed me the fruit of the labor that I had put forward earlier. When I had planted those seeds, when I had done those things that he had told me to do initially, and when I turned around, oh my goodness, there are plants, seed-bearing plants. There's fruit for my actions. There's things that have taken place in my life. The seeds that I planted in my marriage began to bear fruit. The seeds that I planted in my children began to bear fruit. The seeds that we planted here at Living Hope Church have begun to bear fruit. You've seen the changes that have taken place here. They've been very visual. They've been in your face. In the beginning, we weren't really sure about what was going to happen. We walked in here, and there were tables everywhere, and there was dust everywhere, and there was all kinds of stuff that we didn't even know. We went up in the ceiling, and we found trash cans in the ceiling. But as we began to work, and we put the time in, and we planted the seeds, then the walls went up. And we began to paint, and then the painting went up, and we began to hook up the electronics, and there was internet in the building, and there was a coffee bar in the kitchen, and there was a lobby for us to hang out and sit down, and and while there's still some things that are going off over here, we've got children's rooms where they've got wonderful paintings on the wall, and the kids are able to go in, and there's no more nails on the floor, and we've cleaned this up, and we've cleaned that up, and the hallways are clear, because we kept working and allowing things to take place on the other side. So as we saw that, and we began to focus on the ministry again, and we began seeing people come through the door, and we began seeing people who were coming to prayer, and we began to see people who were just being here in this building. And it's amazing when you see new faces. It's funny, during the period of vacation, that end of the year vacation time, I think I saw a lot more new faces than I did some of the normal folks, which was exciting. And being able to go out there and say, hey, this is Living Hope Church. And, you know, this is what we're doing. And this is how we want to connect with you. And this is how we want to love on you. And this is how we want you to experience Jesus. God began to show us how to focus and then how to go back. And then once we turn around and we see all the plants and everything that has taken place, now we can start utilizing some of those resources. If you go into Genesis chapter 1, verses 20 through 24, it says, let the water teem with living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the sky. So God created the great creatures of the sea and every living and moving thing with which the water teems, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them and said, be fruitful and increase in number, and fill the water in the seas, and let the birds increase on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the land produce living creatures according to their kinds, livestock, creatures that move along the ground, and wild animals, each according to its kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals according to their kinds, the livestock according to their kinds, and all the creatures that move along the ground according to their kinds. And God saw that it was good. Question. Would the living creatures have been able to survive without the plants? So without the seed-bearing plants, without the things that they could eat, without the trees for them to live in, those animals wouldn't have had a place to live. Now, we all know that God doesn't operate that way, but in our own lives, don't we do that? I know I have. Where I've started doing something and then kind of let it go and didn't really cultivate it and didn't do some of the other things. Or maybe I didn't plant the initial seed, but I ran ahead for the bonus. You know what I mean? Where you've got something that you should have done first, and you went after the thing that was over here, and you did that first, and now you've got nowhere to sustain it. because you didn't build the foundation first. So in your life, you got to follow this thing in steps. There's an order to the way that God does things. And there's an order to the way that you need to do things. And so as you're in this season of fasting and prayer, ask God to order your steps. Ask him, where should I go first? What should I do next? What should I do next? God may not show you what's going to take place in step 37, but he will give you step 2. Early the next morning, Abraham got up and he started walking. God said, I show you this land, go there. But he didn't tell him which direction to go. He didn't tell him to, you know, you're going to go 1,000 miles this way, then you're going to turn left, and then you're going to go another 1,000 miles this way, then you're going to turn northeast. He didn't do that. He said, put one foot in front of the other and I will guide you. The children of Israel put one foot in front of the other with a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. But it wasn't like the GPS, where the GPS gives you that star all the way at the end to show you where you're going. God was right there. Just follow me. Just follow me. Don't worry about what's going on over here. Don't worry about what's going on over there. Just follow me. When Peter stepped out of the boat, God said, come on. You can step out of the boat. You can walk on water. When did Peter start to sink? What? When he took his eyes off God. When Peter took his eyes off of Jesus, that's when he began to sink. What did he focus on? The wind and the waves. Stuff that was going on to the left and the stuff that was going on to the right. All of the chaos, the whirlwind, all that stuff over here. When you take your eyes off of the guide, the pillar, the one that you should be following, when you stop, you get away from your focus, that's when things start to get out of whack. So refocus yourself. Start to talk to God. This season right now is so very critical for everything that you're going to do for the rest of this year. Every morning when you get up is so critical for what you're going to do for the entire day. The first minute of the hour is so critical to everything you're going to do in that hour. Are you focused? Do you know what you want to do? Have you talked to God about the ideas that you have in your mind? Because God is going to help you see some amazing things happen this year. But you've got to engage with him. You've got to engage with him. And then the last one, well, not really the last one, but this is the last part of Genesis chapter 1. Creating a legacy, 26 through 31. Then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food, and to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. So what you're doing, the things that you're asking God to do, and the things that you build throughout the course of this year, are they sustainable and are they reproducible? Are you able to sustain it even when you're not actively working in it? Is it reproducible? Is it something that you can show someone else and have them follow along? One of the things that we have worked on and worked around is the idea of the reproducing disciple. Having somebody who is discipled in the Word of God and discipled for Christ that then goes out and disciples someone else. That's the model that God gave to us, creating the legacy, going out and building up another believer, showing them how they can work within the kingdom, showing them how to live a life that people want to follow, show them how to bless others and be a blessing to the people around them, and then have those people who come behind that person then be taught to do the same thing. If each one teaches one who then teaches one who then teaches one, we take over the world. Think about it. 12 disciples took over the world for God. We have 100 people in this room. If each one of us commits this year to meet one and teach one, how to meet one and teach one, what would we do by the end of this year? We'd be double. And what if we decided to do that in a faster time frame? What if we did it every month? What if every month we committed to saying, I'm going to meet one person. I'm going to meet one person, and I'm going to work with them, and I'm going to teach them, and I'm going to show them, and I'm going to show them how to go out and reach one more person and have them teach how to reach one more person. We do it every month consistently. What would we do for the body of Christ? I'm concerned about Living Hope Church. I love Living Hope Church. But what about the kingdom? What if we went out and we did that and said, okay, we are just totally committed to having people reached for Christ. And we just went out and we taught them. If we never saw that person in the doors of this building, but we met them every day or every week somewhere and just talked to them about God and talked to them how they've reached someone, what would we be able to do in this area alone? And we know that a lot of folks here are transient. So if you meet someone here and you teach them how to disciple others, and then they move somewhere. Then they go to, let's say, New Jersey. And they go to New Jersey, and they do the same thing there. And then one of the people they meet gets deployed overseas, and that person goes and does this. And then that person begins to move somewhere else. And they take the entire world for Christ just because you made the decision to meet one and teach one. Will you create a legacy this year? Is it even worth it to you to do that? Talk to God during this period. Find out where he wants you to be. Find out what he wants you to do. Talk to him, talk to him, talk to him. That's what this time is for. Don't let this time be lost in the minutia of trying to fast and being focused on, oh, how hungry I am. Okay? I've done that where, you know, I'm not going to eat, and then all I do is I sit around and look at Wendy's commercials. Okay? Focus on God. When you feel that hunger pain, say, God, I am here with you. Where do you want me to go? Show me what I want to do. If you're fasting from television, then when you have that craving to turn on the TV, say, God, I want to just dive deeper into your word. Show me what I want to do. If you're staying away from the internet, then when you should be doing that, and like me, I put the Bible on my phone, so it's right there on the first page. As soon as I turn the phone on, there's a big icon on there that says Bible, and all the other icons are shifted off of the first page now, so that I don't click on the Twitter application or click on the Facebook thing. The only thing that's there is the Bible. So I turn on the phone, and I'm going, oh, well, let me check my email. Oh, look, there's the Bible. Click on that. Got my little daily reader in there, highlights for me, says, hey, Carlton, this is where you stopped last time. It's fantastic. But figure out what you need to do to get yourself in the habit of focusing on God. Because let me tell you something. When you get in that habit, it stops being a have to. I know when we start a season of fasting and prayer and we start anything new, it's always like, oh, I'm trying to get it done and I'm moving forward. But let me tell you something. When you really dive in deep to the word and dive in deep into God, he begins to show you things and you become excited and the only thing you want to do is connect with him. You no longer get into that, oh, I got to read my Bible today. Oh, I got 500 things to do this morning. I can't pray right now. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And you can start running. You'll block off that time. You'll get up in the morning, even if you've got 15 other things to do, and you'll stand up and say, wait a minute, let me pray. And you'll stop and you'll pray and you'll read because God is doing something. He is talking to you and he's imparting life on you, and the Holy Spirit begins to energize your life. And things start to change, and you see your spouse, things happen in your spouse. You start seeing things happen in you. You start seeing things happen in your children. You start seeing things happen in your business and your life. In the folks around you at work, you start seeing things change and things become different, and God starts to pop things up in front of you to remind you, hey, I'm here, and follow after me and do what I want you to do. And it's exciting, and you never lose it as long as you keep walking and focusing on him. It's hard to miss something if you're always looking at it. Amen? And don't get me wrong, that can be dangerous in real life if you're walking around like this all the time. Because you'll bump into people. But you never know. The person you bump into may be somebody you need to talk to. So 2010, what will you do with this year? As we go into fasting and prayer, what will you do? How will you be different this year than you were last year? How will your life be different? How will your walk with God be different? How will your relationship with God be different? And I didn't forget, I know there's one more day left. I didn't forget that one. And in Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. And God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. Please, this year, 2010, find time to rest. Find time to rest. Find time to rest. Now, when I say rest, I don't mean sleep, okay? Now, I know there's some folks out there that probably need some sleep. And you need to take that too. Make sure you get the amount of sleep you need to have. But just because it says rest doesn't mean that you need to go lay down. But you need to do things that refresh you. You need to do things that energize you. We are such a 100-mile-an-hour whirlwind society that we often don't take time out to enjoy the work that we do. People that I know that make, you know, that make lots of money, that do all the things, that have all the trappings of, you know, this is a great life, man. They got a big house and cars and they travel, but they're not really relaxed. They go on a vacation and they got the phone is buzzing and they're answering, they're calling people and all kinds of stuff is going on and they're never resting. And God said, rest. There is no other person who has more energy than God. God was not tired at the end of creation. He didn't go, ooh-wee, I need to sit back and take a break. No, he was giving us a model to rest. And he said, make it holy. Rest. Rest. I need this more than anybody else because I never sit still. I very rarely sleep, and I very rarely sit still. But here's the thing. When I have gotten off track, and I've run, God shows up. And he'll whisper the first time. He'll say, hey, Carlton, you need to slow down, start resting. And I'll just be like, I got to get this done, and I keep going. And then he'll say, hey, Carlton, slow down. And I just keep running and keep running and keep running. And then before long, there's the smack. And now I'm limping. So for those of you who know, I spent some time not being able to walk because I run all the time. And it's a metaphor because, of course, you know, I don't really run all the time. But God was slowing me down, because if I did, it would look much better. But here's the thing. God was slowing me down. And this has happened to me on two very distinct occasions. One time, it ended up with me in the hospital for 4 days. Because I had so many things going on. We had a church in Houston that we were working at and spending so much time, energy invested in. And I had two businesses. I had a full-time job. I had a wife. I had a child. And we were running. And God was saying, no, you need to slow down. You need to focus on me. You need to stop trying to take over the world. And I ignored him. And then one night, I'm sitting in my house, and my foot is the size of a basketball. Well, football. But there I was in my house trying to figure out how am I going to get to work the next day, not being able to walk on my foot. Trying to figure out, what am I going to do? I got to call these people. I got these folks to call. I got appointments to get to. I mean, I got to get to church on Sunday. I got to sing in the worship team, and I got to pray, and I got to read the scripture, and I got to be prepared for this. And we got to go over here and help this person, and we got to go over there and do that. And God was saying, you need to stop it. Spent 3 years running in a circle like a chicken with his head cut off. You wouldn't listen. So have a seat. And it was during those 4 days that I was in the hospital that God began to talk to me about resting. And I spent the next 2 years living a somewhat different life. Changed, but not all the way. Because then I moved back here and started doing the same thing. And God was telling me, slow down. And I didn't. And one day, just normal, just walking, and off the curb I went. And I said, it's no big deal. I just slipped off the curb. keep going, making phone calls, doing this, doing that, going to do this, staying up late, not getting any sleep. And all of a sudden, I wake up one morning, 2 days later, and I can't walk on it. And I said, you know what, God, are you telling me the exact same thing you told me a couple years ago? And he's like, yeah. And you know what I did? I ignored it. Kept going, went to work, put my shoes on, kept walking around, not resting, not listening. And I'm telling you guys this because this is what God does, okay? Like I said in the beginning, he's not going to just show up and hit you over the head. He's giving you the opportunities to work within the framework that he built. He wants you to remember who he is. He wants you to focus on him. But after a while, and you get way outside in left field or right field, right field, you have to be course corrected back. So I'm saying that because I don't want you to do that in 2010. I don't want to do that in 2010. Let's focus on him. Let's talk to him. We're going to start the fasting and prayer next Sunday. I would recommend you start today. But if not, this week, spend time really talking to God and ask him, what do I need to look at over this next 21 days? What do I need to look at during this season of fasting and prayer? What do I need to reevaluate in my life? What do I need to do differently? What do I need? How do I need to walk? How do I need to, you know, what is it that I have to do, God? Tell me. Because I want to hear from you. I don't want to make the decisions on my own. I don't want, because as you can see, I can't do it right on my own. But hey, I want to listen to you. I'm coming and my heart is open to what you have to say. And let him talk to you. Let him show you. Dive into the word. See what God has already communicated. It's all right there. Everything you possibly could need, every question you could ask is right there. And even if you need something, pray and ask. How cool is that? You can pray and ask God and he will answer you. He will answer you. So, 2010, a new year, a new opportunity, a fresh start. What will you do this year? What will you do with 2010? Let's pray. God, we thank you this morning for reminders and ideas. Reminders of what we've done in our lives and reminders of who you are and what you're doing. And God, we thank you for the ideas that you're going to plant over this next 21 days. God, remind us how to do and walk the way that you've called us to walk. Show us the ministry opportunities. Show us the things that we can do. Show us how we best serve people for your kingdom. But God, most of all, show us how to connect with you. Show us how to have a great relationship with you. Show us how to focus on you. Show us how to be with you in a new way. You're amazing, God, and we thank you. And I would never want to take this time and talk to you, God, and be here before the people without also saying, if you don't know, if there's a person here in this building that doesn't know you, if there's someone who's watching this message right now who doesn't know who you are, God, I ask that you would reveal yourself to them. Show them who you are, that you're a God who created everything, that you created them, a God who wants and desires to be in a relationship with that individual. And God, I ask that you would show them that because of the sin nature, the sins of mankind, that their relationship was broken. And that, God, you came in the form of your son Jesus, and you came down and you lived a sinless life. You lived a sinless life and you went to the cross for that person. You went to the cross and you went into the grave to redeem them because they couldn't do it on their own, and that it is simple but not easy for them to understand who you are. All they've got to do, God, is acknowledge you. They got to acknowledge you as the Lord and the Savior of their life. And then they acknowledge that they're sinners and that they need a Savior. Then they need to accept that gift of salvation, that you went to the cross for them, that you died for their sins, so that they would have relationship. And God, I ask that you would also show them that then they need to embrace you as a Savior. Embrace you and embrace the relationship. Not step away from it. Stick with it. Focus on you. And that if they would just pray that you would come into their lives, that you would be the Lord of their lives, that you would show them where they have fallen short and then show them how you have redeemed them in spite of themselves. God, show them so that they would understand who you are, that they would find folks who are also believers and connect with them in a meaningful way, and that they would also walk in this 2010 message and understand that they can talk to you about what they're going to do this year, that they would be able to have joy, they would never be alone, they would never be in want because they will have relationship with you. God, we thank you for this time of prayer. As we prepare to sing worship here in the service, God, let us stay in that attitude of prayer. Let us stay in that attitude of focusing on you. Let us listen to your voice as we finish up this service. And God, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.